This is the Acorn Archimedes, released in 1987. It was the first computer with an ARM processor that was commercially available to the general public. But this is just a photo of that computer in a browser, running on a Windows emulator, running on a phone with an ARM processor.
Well, I'm ready to tell you about this.
The REDMAGIC 9S Pro, which contains the Snapdragon 8 Gen 3 leading version chipset, currently the world's best mobile ARM processor on the market. Also found in this year's flagship Samsung S24 and similar to the standard version of the chip found in the Xiaomi 14 and OnePlus 12. But in this device, it has a slightly higher maximum clock speed, optimized power efficiency, and yes, I do have to mention it, enhanced AI features. Now, while this video is sponsored by REDMAGIC, I've been wanting to talk about the ARM architecture for a while now, especially since ARM chips have been coming all the way back around to the mainline PC market, what they were originally designed for. Still, I don't think REDMAGIC expected me to try to install Windows 11 and create the world's first Android game written in ARM assembly, but come on, you can't just expect me to not write just a little assembly code. The SoC found in the REDMAGIC 9S Pro contains at its core a 64-bit ARM CPU with clock speeds up to 3.4 GHz, along with a GPU running at up to 1 GHz. This is the Frost version of the device, which has 12 GB of LPDDR5X RAM and 256 GB of storage. And what I find really interesting is this switch on the side of the device, which opens up the game space, a mode that focuses the system's computing power on running a specific program. That's definitely something you don't just see on any mobile computer, so I'll be sure to make good use of this later in the video. But first, let's talk about the advanced reduced instruction set computer machine architecture that's been around for nearly just as long as x86 at this point. I'm sure at this point we all know the story by heart of how the original Acorn RISC Machine CPU became highly regarded for its heritage and renewal projects, including the refurbishment of Hamer Hall at Arts Centre Melbourne. Wrong Wikipedia article there. Well, anyways, the moral of the story is that ARM is a RISC architecture, which means that it's super power efficient. Between dynamic voltage scaling, power gating, and optimized memory subsystems, it's really no wonder that these chips have such great performance at low power levels. Except that none of that has anything to do with the chip's instruction set architecture. Chips from Intel, AMD, and other companies also incorporate DVS power gating and optimized memory subsystems among the many other power optimizations in their own chips. It turns out that the reason ARM chips are so power efficient is because they're designed for low power devices like your phone, smartwatch, or mobile dog. It has nothing to do with having a RISC or CISC or BISC architecture, it's the implementation of the chip design that matters most, not the ISA. If you're still not convinced, there's a great article from Chips and Cheese on this that I'll link down below. And just for the record, Japan's Fugaku supercomputer based on the Fujitsu A64FX ARM CPU draws much more power than the current world's fastest supercomputer, the Frontier, which runs on x86 CPUs. But of course, that doesn't mean that ARM chips like the Snapdragon 8 Gen 3 aren't more power efficient than ever. And those are real benefits that can be taken advantage of in a device like this with a 6500 mAh battery supplying up to 56 hours of usage. So what's the real difference between these two ISAs? Well, x86 64 CPUs have 16 general purpose registers, while ARM 64 CPUs on the other hand have 31 general purpose registers. Yet at a basic level, x86 and ARM instructions do pretty much the same thing: calculations, logic, branching, reading and writing to and from memory. So maybe the most obvious difference here is that ARM is a load store architecture. And while x86 has, over the years, expanded to include so many other complex instructions for SMID, cryptography, and virtualization support, at the same time, the ARM instruction set has also expanded to support those same features. So I guess it's no surprise then that while x86 64 CPUs have a total instruction variant count of 3,684, ARM itself has somewhere in the ballpark of 1,300 or more instruction variants. It's really no surprise either that today's top-of-the-line smartphone SoCs outshine top-spec desktop CPUs from only a few years ago, well outdo the best Chromebooks currently on the market, and let's just say that I really hope that the Nintendo Switch Color has some serious hardware upgrades. In fact, do you even need a PC at all at this point? What exactly can you do on a PC that you can't do on a phone like the REDMAGIC 9S Pro? I mean, look at this, I can play Snake on the home screen. What does your desktop do? The REDMAGIC 9S Pro is touted as the phone for the gamers of the world, and if their virtual AI assistant doesn't make it clear enough, they are definitely trying to be in tune with that market segment. But there are some other genuinely great features here that break down the barrier between mobile and desktop. For starters, this device is equipped with an in-house designed Red Core 2 Pro chipset that focuses on touch, vibration, sound, and lighting effect support to give the main CPU additional bandwidth to focus on other important computational tasks. And if that isn't enough, try flipping the game space switch, then in any game you can use additional features to show system info, record the screen, try out any of these other game plugins, or for anything that requires heavy CPU or GPU demands, set the performance mode to as high as you want it to go. Being able to connect the device to an external monitor via USB or wirelessly, flip the game space switch, and do completely separate tasks on that screen and the phone allows for it to be treated as a kind of two-in-one computer, especially if you hook up a Bluetooth keyboard and mouse so that you can just put your phone down and forget you're even running this off a mobile device. And by the way, there isn't any ridiculous camera bump on the back or obnoxious island on the front. There's still a camera in there, it's just below the screen and you can only barely see it when you go looking for it. Of course, we won't get the feeling of a true PC experience without Big Brother Microsoft looking out for us. And although Windows is on ARM, it's just not possible to boot into Windows from a device like this, since there'd be no way to interact with it without the supporting drivers. But while Windows can't be experienced natively, there are some alternatives we can resort to for a Windows-like experience. There's direct emulation through the likes of QEMU, but while I was able to get Tiny 11 to boot nearly all the way up, it failed close to the end of the process, and no matter what settings I changed, I was never quite able to make it go all the way there. Although apparently some people have had great success and adequate performance results emulating the Windows on ARM version of Windows 11. What works for me is the WinLater app, which allows the user to run Windows x86 64 programs through Wine, x86, and x64. In the app, I can simply create a new container and even specify what kind of GPU hardware to emulate. Then once running, we're not actually in Windows proper, but an environment that will let us run Windows x86 64 programs, like this one, or, okay, not that one. Not every program will run, and I'm fairly sure there's only support for up to DirectX 9 here, so typing Simulator 3D using DirectX 11 is out of the question. But at least we have Minesweeper, Solitaire, a really slow version of Internet Explorer, and even Google Chrome, as long as you don't care about JavaScript working at all. To be honest, trying to run x86 programs probably isn't worth it, and while you could just always remote into your desktop using Steam, the new Windows app, or whatever else, that kind of defeats the purpose of having such a powerful CPU on this device. There has been some recent news about Valve testing Proton support for ARM64, so there very well could come a day when a phone like this can just run PC games from Steam, since for many titles it's not a question of available computational power, but platform support. So while it's great to go off and play in the land of make-believe x86 Windows, at the end of the day, this is an ARM device and we'll get the best performance running programs built for ARM. So if we really want to use Chrome that badly, turns out there's an app for that. In fact, pretty much anything the average person wants to do on a PC, you can do on a phone nowadays. Considering that Google's Office apps are more popular than Microsoft's at this point, it may not be the craziest idea to get a portable monitor, keyboard, and mouse and ditch the e-waste. With so many apps and games available for Android, a device like the REDMAGIC 9S Pro with its AMOLED screen with a dynamic refresh between 60 and 120Hz and a super efficient cooling system, it has no trouble rendering the most popular games at the highest quality. But I can't think of a better method to dive into the beating heart of the system and to get a good look at just what the ARM ISA can do than writing an app in ARM64 assembly. I guess what I'm saying is that I'll basically do anything to avoid programming in Java. While it's possible to use pure assembly to write an app, getting any kind of GUI support won't be very easy. Luckily, a while ago, I came across a video explaining how to write full Android apps in plain old C, and additionally, they provided an associated graphics library. So, through the magic of the compiler, I can also include an assembly file into the list of files to be wrapped up into the final app. And did you see how that compiled in like 2 seconds? That's so much better than the year and a half it takes through Android Studio. And having this separate assembly file is by far easier than having to rely on the clunky syntax and restrictions of inline assembly embedded in the C program. The way this app is designed, all the logic and data behind the game is run within the assembly code section of the program that outputs a 224x288 buffer that represents the game screen. This buffer is then taken and processed by the rest of the app's C code using the provided RawDraw graphics library to output the game onto the device's screen. In fact, besides that, the only thing the C code is doing is determining the proper frame timing and reading the touchscreen input to determine the direction of the virtual joystick, which is then passed on to the assembly program to calculate the next frame of the game. You could almost think of this as a Pac-Man on a chip at the center of this program, since you could easily port this core assembly section over to any other ARM machine. Here's what it looks like when the game doesn't scale up the final output. It's just crazy to think of how pixel-dense phones have gotten nowadays. In terms of the assembly code itself, I called upon all my experience of programming the NES and Game Boy to treat this game as if it was being written for an 8-bit machine. Pac-Man and the ghost are all treated as sprites with an associated X and Y location and character from the game's character ROM, and other game variables are all kept within the virtual zero page of the machine. After going through the game's logic, the sprites are drawn on top of the background and then sent onto the output buffer. I won't lie, I'm not a huge fan of ARM assembly syntax. My assembly code certainly doesn't make use of hardly any complex tricks and techniques, but I do appreciate some useful features like adding a condition to an instruction. When copying sprites onto the output screen, I can first check if the pixel color is the background color of the character ROM, and if so, skip copying that pixel. This would have required a separate label and branching to do the same thing in another assembly language. For being the world's first ARM assembly mobile game, I don't think it turned out half bad, and if you'd be interested in seeing a deeper dive into the design of this game, just leave a comment down below. Of course, the REDMAGIC 9S Pro has no trouble running this game as normal or a dozen copies of it all at once, which is to be expected given its performance with top-of-the-line games. With ARM chips now coming back around to the desktop scene, it may be only a matter of time until the line between your PC and phone is blurred beyond recognition. Honestly, if I can fit an entire PC in the palm of my hand, I'm all the more grateful for that convenience. If you're interested in checking out this device for yourself, I'll leave a link to it down below. But wait, did you just say there's no titanium in this thing? Seriously? Oh, it's basically a paperweight at this point.